And here we are coming to you live once again from the top secret broadcasting bunker here at Area 52. This is Pastor Mike, and I'm ready to read some pieces of paper to you, and I'm ready to do a Bible study, and I'm ready to take your questions, and I might even be able to give an answer. Who knows? Good to be with you today. The weather outside is absolutely gorgeous here in Festus, Missouri. And if you're just looking for a place to be, Missouri's the place. Where apparently we have terrorists on the loose. Where is that story? And I didn't know about this. I heard it from people who live in other places. I didn't hear it from, I get up every morning and my wife usually crawls out of bed before I do. I don't know, 10, 15 minutes of laying there deciding whether I want to live or not. And I'll turn the news on and watch the news. And I did not hear anything about this. A couple of terrorists, I don't know if they're terrorists or not, but one of them definitely was. There was a terrorist yesterday in St. Louis that tried to blow up a bus. They caught him at the emergency room because apparently he burned his lips on the tailpipe. That was pretty good, wasn't it? And Jazz fell for it. I told her that when she fell for it. But apparently this is not a joke. Federal authorities, and this is from the Post-Dispatch, St. Louis Post-Dispatch. Federal authorities in the Cape Girardeau County Sheriff's Department. Cape Girardeau is about an hour and a half south of Festus, right down I-55. Federal authorities in Cape Girardeau County Sheriff's Department are investigating an apparent explosion at a county bridge. The explosion occurred early Sunday near Oak Ridge. The Southeast Missourian reports that no one was hurt, but people living near the bridge on County Road 459 reporting hearing a loud noise. The Federal Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives and Methamphetamine is helping with the investigation. Authorities say the damage appeared to have been caused by some type of explosive device. Duh. So people heard an explosion. They view the bridge, there's debris everywhere, and the authorities, who are very well trained and highly paid, who have the entire expertise and systems of the entire federal government at their hand, at their discretion, have determined scientifically that it appears some sort of explosive device has gone off. That's what it appears like. And in all seriousness, I do not think terrorists. I don't think Muslim terrorists. I don't think any other kind of terrorist. County roads, bridges on county roads. I mean, I know what those are like here, and I've been in other places. Cape Girardeau is in southeast Missouri, going toward the boot heel of Missouri. If you don't know what that is, just look at a map. And you'll see the boot heel of Missouri. I don't know why we got stuck with that little appendix of property that extends down into Arkansas, but we got stuck with it. And I know some people from that area and so on, and I can tell you it is redneck, hillbilly, farmer boy heaven. And it's a haven for people who love to shoot and blow stuff up. And I've got it in my mind. There's a couple of bearded, beer-drinking rednecks down in that county that said, hey, hold my beer. Watch this. Some guy he's been watching YouTube videos, learned how to build himself a bomb, and he decided he's going to blow him up a bridge and see if it work or not. I think that's what happened. But I did not hear about this on local television. I don't know why they didn't run this one, but I had to hear about it from other people. Apparently it's true that the American Muslim Political Action Committee, AMPAC, is going to hold a million Muslim march on 9/11. I started with this story the other day. I asked for verification. A lot of you sent me some emails. I appreciate it. Apparently, it's true, and it still hacks me off that they're going to pick this day to march on Washington, D.C. That is, it is highly offensive to me. Not as a Christian, because great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. You can't practice your religion out loud enough, and it offend me. Because I know I have the truth, I believe the truth, I am free in the truth. And if you choose to disregard that truth, do so at your own expense. But your religion and the practice of it does not infringe upon my religion whatsoever. I don't care if you eliminate Jerusalem completely off the map. I don't need Jerusalem. I don't need the Vatican. I don't need a church building. I don't need a cross hanging over my neck. I don't need a bumper sticker. I don't need anything. I have my Bible, and I have the Word hidden in my heart. And your religion never one time has infringed on my faith and my trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and the Word of God. So you know what? Practice your false religion all you want to. It doesn't affect me one bit. I think it's strange. I can't understand why in the world you would want to be part of a religion that is steeped in hatred and murder and blood. I don't know why anybody, any human being, would want to be part of that. But it doesn't bother me that you want to be a Muslim and you want to be out there with your religion. I couldn't care less. It offends me as an American. It offends me as a patriot and a countryman and someone who loves this nation. And it was people of your religious ilk and your ideology that attacked my country on September 11th, 2001. And it is highly offensive to me as an American citizen, as someone who was born on this land, whose fathers and relatives fought and spilled their blood and saw their brethren with guts all over the place. My uncle was he was in the Marines in World War II. I got an uncle that was in the Marines in World War II in those Pacific Islands. And he told me the story one time about one of his buddies calling for him. Hey, I need help over here. And he looked over there and he said, what? He said, help me put this back in. And his guts literally were hanging all over the place. Out there fighting against an enemy that wanted to destroy our nation. And you pick this day to go and rally and rally people around your cause. You are offensive to every red-blooded, true American. That's what you are. You're offensive. And apparently it's going to go on. Here is the American Muslim Political Action Committee. We at AMPAC are planning an historic event for 9/11/13 where 1 million Muslims will march to Washington, D.C. and demand that our civil rights be protected by our government. Who do you think you are? You don't want your civil rights. You want Sharia law. You want to rule over everybody else in this country because you think that your God is supreme. That's what you want. You want all of the American women to be bound up in veils and curtains and everything else and to be able to shoot them in the streets and beat them severely for even the mere thought of using a cell phone. That's what you want. You don't want civil rights. You want dominion, and it's offensive to me. We're demanding that laws be enacted. Listen, here we go. We are demanding that laws be enacted protecting our First Amendment. Our First Amendment. We're asking President Obama to fulfill his promise from his first campaign for presidency of a transparent government. Lastly, we are asking for the release of the 9/11 Commission report to the American people. On 9/11, our country was forever changed by the horrific events in New York. The entire country was victimized by the acts done on that day. Muslim and non-Muslim alike were traumatized, but we as Muslims continue 12 years later to be victimized by being made the villains. Well, it wasn't a bunch of Southern Baptists on those planes, was it? Wasn't a bunch of Pentecostals. To this day, every media outlet and anti-Islamic organization has committed slanderous and libel statements against us as Muslims and our religion of Islam. Yet our government either sits idly by and does nothing to protect our freedoms, or it exacerbates the problem with its constant war on terrorism in Islamic countries, congressional hearings on Islam in America, and its changes to the law. If I was in the American government, I would not be near as interested in what every American home was downloading on the internet. I would be more interested in the terrorist extremism that is rampant in the Muslim community that is going to be displayed next month. That's what I would be interested in. I don't know. I'm not a prophet, not a prognosticator. But this doesn't look good. I don't know if anything's going to happen. I am absolutely put out by this. It offends me. It makes me angry that we have gotten to this point in this country, and you're mad at Barack Obama, and he's been doing nothing but for the last 5-6 years going around kissing the backsides of every... There's war. There's more instability in Egypt right now. The lead article on the Drudge Report, Rise of the Brotherhood. They're burning Christian churches, burning homes, burning Coptic churches. That's the Muslim Brotherhood. That's who this administration sided with to get the Egyptian president out of office. And they put that Muslim Brotherhood guy in, Morsi, and it backfired. The people said, we don't want this guy. He's an extremist. He's turning our country into something we don't like. And they threw him out. So now the Muslim Brotherhood is on the rise again. It makes me wonder who's behind this. But to this AMPAC committee, that's the guy. That's your guy. You got your president in the White House. Why are you complaining? And I'm telling you, people, they don't want equal rights. They will not stop. And it's just like the sodomites. They will not stop until this country is burning. Neither the Muslims, nor the sodomites, nor the liberals, nor the environmentalists. I read an article a couple weeks ago, and I think I agree with it. The writer of the article, it was an editorial, and he was saying, he was commenting on those 19 firefighters down in Arizona that lost their lives in that fire. It just destroyed them. And the editorial went on to say like this: you know who was at fault? You know how those guys got killed? The environmentalists killed them. They said 100 years ago in this country, you would have fires like that would last all day and a half. And they would go out by themselves because they ran out of fuel. But in the last 30, 40, 50 years, these environmentalists have prohibited the American Forestry Service and the Park Service and all these other agencies from doing these controlled burns in these forested areas or these wildland areas, doing controlled burns. That's what gets rid of the shrubbery and the fuel that fuels these fires. So instead of smart people wanting to do what God told us to do, that is subdue the land, put it under your rule, and take dominion over it. And so the Forestry Service, I'm a big fan of conservation. The Missouri Conservation Department, I know it's a government entity, but they have done a good job. When I was a boy, the deer population in Missouri was so low that you could get a buck tag for deer season, And if you were one of the lucky selected few, you could get a doe tag. But very, very few people got a tag to be able to kill a doe deer in the state of Missouri. And the conservation department has done so well that now they give you one buck permit. And in most counties, not all, but in most counties in Missouri, you can get unlimited doe tags. Why? Because the conservation department did its job, and they did it well. And you had all of these people, and I know they work for the government, but they're not all bad, and they're not all idiots. They were saying, you know, we got to burn this stuff every now and then because it builds up and it's a danger. So the environmentalists don't let them do that because they found a snail hiding under a shrub somewhere, and they said, that's his home. You're going to burn his home down. That imagine how the snail feels. He's sad. See, he's sad. He's sad. So they enact all these stupid laws where they can't do what needs to be done, and all this fuel builds up, and that's what killed those firemen. We're going to burn this country down one way or the other. Whether it's the Muslims with Sharia law or the sodomites. Jerry Brown, past and present governor of the state of California, state of insanity, signs trans student protection bill. Governor Jerry Brown signed into law groundbreaking bill expanding anti-discrimination protections for transgender students in public and elementary and secondary schools, mandating that schools respect the gender identity of trans students by allowing them equal access to the sports teams, programs, facilities associated with their gender. And it's like I said, in those of you living in California, if I were you and I were smart, I would pull my kids out of the public school in a heartbeat because some boy is fixing to walk in on your daughter in the bathroom. And if your daughter complains or says anything about it, he's not going to get in trouble. Your daughter's going to get in trouble. And you're going to be down there at that school raising Cain. And they're going to have you listed as a troublemaker and a homophobe and breaking the law because you couldn't let your daughter go to the bathroom in peace. Assembly Bill 1266 is the first of its kind nationwide and expands upon existing anti-discrimination protections to help schools implement policies that support and affirm transgendered students. It builds upon national momentum to respect trans students, including a ruling earlier this year from the Colorado Civil Rights Division, determining that a trans first grader must be allowed access to the girls' bathroom at her elementary school near Colorado Springs. California's new law will take effect January 1st, according to the Bay Area Reporter. While many California school children are already protected by policies in some of our biggest school districts, other districts don't seem to understand that transgender students should have equal access to all programs and facilities, said Assemblyman Tom Amaniano, a gay Democrat from San Francisco, introduced the bill. The gender identity of these kids needs to be respected, and they shouldn't have to sue to make it happen. The bill passed both the state and Senate assembly last month despite opposition from right-wing and religious groups that claimed the legislation would allow boys to shower with girls and lead to students randomly using whatever bathroom they felt like on a given day. Hey, guys, you remember high school, don't you? So, would you put it past, I'm not saying you, not me, but some of the guys we went to high school with, I wouldn't put it past them to start wearing a dress at school for about a week just so they could go into the girls' shower room after PE. I wouldn't put it past them. And it's going to happen, and you can't do a thing about it. it's not going to stop until we burn the nation to the ground. It's not going to stop until that happens. This was from theadvocate.com. Apparently, it's a gay rights website. And they had an article listed in connection with this one that I thought was kind of funny. It's called Golden Age of Nile, Hercules, the bisexual demigod. Hercules has been the icon of alpha masculinity for centuries. Did you know about his gay love life? Dwayne Johnson and somebody else have Hercules films coming out next year in the spring and summer, respectively. Sure seems like a long time to wait, so to kill some time, and until then, we thought we'd dig into the myth and love life, the most famous alpha male of all time. And they're both playing Hercules, and Hercules, along with these others, is the bigendered androgynous god, the male-female, the boy-girl, the man-woman. And let me just say this, I've run into these people before. And I challenged them to go to the Word of God, and it stunned and amazed me when I got challenged. I don't remember where it was, but somebody at a Club O Prophecy meeting that I was at, because I had mentioned from the Da Vinci Code this idea that God, you know, the God that you and I serve from the King James Bible, this idea that God that you and I believe in was both male and female. And I built it up and I led it up to this concept of Baphomet to try to teach them that's the God that's both male and female. And I said, it is an abomination to consider our God as a woman and a man at the same time. And I got shouted out by a lady in that meeting. She didn't like what I said. She said, he is too. She is, or something like that. I said, no, it's not pretty. You know what it was? She was ticked off that I exposed Kenneth Copeland because of his quote teaching everybody that God was both male and female at the same time. And I exposed that as heresy and abomination. And she got ticked off that I named Kenneth Copeland's name. It made her mad. You never know when Jezebel's sitting in the crowd until you really make her mad. And then she's not going to keep her mouth shut. Obamacare provision. Forced home inspections. I ran into stuff like this years ago doing research in some of the school programs that were coming out. School programs like Parents as Teachers and all this stuff. The Parents as Teachers program in the state of Missouri actually was more about the teachers as parents. And it set up situations where social workers and investigators would go visit the home of some of these students because they were at risk for something. At risk for something. And even back then, some of these school social workers, they were trained to go and look around at the house and try to see what was going on in that house. And they had a list of criteria for students that would be at risk for something. And it was, are the parents, are they overweight? Are those parents have an eating problem? Does one of the parents smoke cigarettes? That could be a sign of an at-risk child. What were they watching on television when you came to the house? They were teaching them to go snooping around through these people's houses because these children were potentially in harm's way, being at risk for something. And I guess all this information gets fed to the social services and this and that and the other. According to an Obamacare provision, millions of Americans will be targeted. The Health and Human Services website states that your family will be targeted if you fall under the high-risk category shown. Families, number one, families where mom is not yet 21. That's a high risk for something. Families where someone is a tobacco user. See? high risk for something. You know what? In my younger days, when I was a little boy, my mom was a tobacco user. And my mom was a tremendous mother. Great woman. To this day, she is one of my best friends. My mom and I are close. I cannot imagine being yanked out of my house because I was at risk for something. Because my mom struggled with cigarettes early on. When she started coming to church here at Bethel in 1974, it took her a few years for God to finally take those away from her, and he did. She didn't do it on her own. God did it for her. Families with individuals who are serving or formerly served in the armed forces, including such families that have members of the armed forces who have had multiple deployments outside the United States. So, you know, that's pretty good. United States of America sends these boys over to do these disgusting things over there that some of them probably are not right. They come back with their head messed up. And now we're going to treat them bad and think their families are at risk. There is families where children have low student achievement, developmental delays, or disabilities. There's no reference to Medicaid being the determinant for a family to be eligible. In 2011, the Health and Human Services announced $224 million would be given to support evidence-based home visiting programs to, quote, help parents and children. I'm from the government, and I'm here to help you. Individuals from the state will implement these leveraging strategies to enhance program sustainability. Constitutional attorney and author Kent Masterson Brown states this is not a voluntary program. The eligible entity receiving the grant for performing the home visits is to identify the individuals to be visited and intervene so as to meet the improvement benchmarks. A homeschooling family, for instance, may be subject to intervention. Get ready, guys. Get ready. We fought them with the Department of Education. We fought against the NEA, the National Teachers Education Association. We fought against the teachers unions. I had friends years ago that went to Jefferson City every congressional session because they said, Mike, every time a school bill is introduced in the Missouri legislature, there is always wording in there that will make some new provision that will be forced upon homeschool and private school students. And we have to go there and fight against this thing to make sure that the law specifically says that it's only for public school kids. So we fought against them and fought against them and fought against them. And this year, both of my boys are homeschooled. Matthew, junior in high school, he spent his freshman year, sophomore year, at the high school level here in Hillsborough. And Hillsborough's a small town, small school district. But he told us, he said, Dad, I can't take it anymore. He said, guys are kissing in the hallway. And he said, they had Gay Pride Day. And he said, I don't want to be a part of it anymore. I can't take it anymore. It was his choice. He walked out. He said, I'm not doing it. And we pulled Caleb out last year because Caleb, he's like me. Actually, he's like way beyond me. This kid loves guns. And he plays commando and Navy SEAL, and he's good at it. I could be in my house and walk into the living room and sit down with my glass of beverage. And all of a sudden, Caleb pops out with this little toy or something like that and says, grenade. And I'm going, where did you come from? But he plays guns all the time. And we had it figured that he was going to be on the school grounds with his buddies like we used to do. We used to play Army and Planet of the Apes and the Bionic Man. We used to play all that stuff. He's going to do that one day, and I'm going to have to be down in that principal's office letting him have it for being an idiot, for throwing my kid out of school because he pretended. pulled them out. Get ready, everybody. A homeschooling family, for instance, may be subject to intervention in school readiness and social, emotional, developmental indicators. A farm family may be subject to intervention in order to prevent child injuries. The sky is the limit. And you remember somebody from the Obama administration a couple years ago wanted to implement this new dictate that said children who were on farms could not work on the farm. And the people uproared. They said that is the most retarded, stupid thing anybody has ever done. It is the farmers and children being raised on a farm that built this nation into what it is. It's teaching them a work ethic. It's teaching them how to live off the land, teaching them how to provide with their own hands. And you're wanting to take that away from them. Bunch of garbage. So here they come. They couldn't do it with the Department of Labor. They couldn't do it with the Department of Education. So now they're going to do it through the Department of Health and Human Services. Here we go. I believe that a man's family, and so far the American government, up until a certain point in history, has said that a man and his family is a sacred thing. Men, a husband and a wife have primary jurisdiction over those children. They have rights over those children. Now the United Nations moves in with this equal rights for the protection of children nonsense. You know what? I started today the Watchman broadcast for this weekend and for the next like 27,000 weekends is going to be on the Fourth Kingdom. And the thought occurred to me, and just follow me on this. I like this. And God gave me this while I'm teaching it. The image that Nebuchadnezzar saw in his dream started out with the head of gold. And that was Nebuchadnezzar. And then silver, and then bronze, and then iron, and then finally iron and dirt, miry clay. And it occurred to me while I'm presenting this today that the kingdom of the Antichrist starts out with gold and ends up with dirt. And God's, you know, this, the interpretation of the dream was that after you, Nebuchadnezzar, there's going to be a lesser kingdom. That's silver, because silver's not as expensive as gold. And brass, you can get brass anywhere. And then iron and dirt, see, it goes down both in strength and value. So by the time we get to the New World Order, which is coming now, you know what I think? I think you and I really don't have much to be afraid of with the New World Order. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, people. They're going to try to take away our rights. Big deal. You belong to the kingdom of God. You're an heir to the promises of Abraham. Stand strong in that. Don't be afraid of these people. Don't be afraid of what they can do to you. Don't do it. Their kingdom has been going downhill ever since Nebuchadnezzar. And then they're going to just be turned into powder and be blown away as the chaff on the summer threshing floor. I love the Word of God. I absolutely do. Anyway, they're coming to take me away. Ha ha. They're coming to take me away. Ha ha. Kudos. Lavabit.com. Let me read this. I haven't even read this yet. I kind of knew what it was about. There was an email company that when the government and they dealt with private email, and their role was, and their sales pitch was, Gmail reads all of your emails and targets you for advertising, and now they're going to turn over that information to the government for no reason whatsoever. So this email company that specialized in private email, when the government approached them and said, we need access to your servers, You know what the guy did? Shut the company down. Just like that. He said, I'd rather quit and go broke before I let you do that. Good for him. See, and I don't know if this guy's saved or lost. If he's lost, it seems like to me he stands up more than some of the people who say they're Christians. This is from Lavabit.com. My fellow users, I've been forced to make a difficult decision to become complicit in crimes against the American people or walk away from nearly 10 years of hard work by shutting down Lavabit. After significant soul searching, I've decided to suspend operations. I wish that I could legally share with you the events that led to my decision. I cannot. I feel you deserve to know what's going on. The First Amendment is supposed to guarantee me the freedom to speak out in situations like this. Unfortunately, Congress has passed laws that say otherwise. As things currently stand, I cannot share my experiences over the last 6 weeks, even though I have twice made the appropriate requests. What's going to happen now? We've already started preparing the paperwork needed to continue to fight for the Constitution in the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals. Or Apples. Court of Apples. Anyway, a favorable decision would allow me to resurrect Lavabit as an American company. This experience has taught me one very important lesson. Without congressional action or strong judicial precedent, I would strongly recommend against anyone trusting their private data to a company with physical ties to the United States. Sincerely, Ladar Levison, owner and operator of Lavabit LLC. Defending the Constitution is expensive. And they, you can say you can donate to the Lavabit Legal Defense Fund here. Take stand, people. Take stand. You're Christians, right? Oh, let's see here. What else can I get my mouth run into? Here's one sent to me. Daniel sent this to me. He said, the other Bethel, the anti-Bethel, he's been listening. The anti-Bethel church, that's Bethel, Redding, California, Bill Johnson's church, is kicking this event off. I personally won't be heading to any of the stadiums. Seems like revivals have always moved east to west in the past. And this is, and the reason why I'm doing this, this is another example of these big revivals. God is going to be pouring out multitudes of blessings. The greatest thing that God has ever done is just around the corner. Why don't you come to our... Listen to this. Revival in the USA, is it on the way? I want you to lift up your voice believing God intends to pour out his spirit from Los Angeles to New York City, from the West Coast to the East Coast, and he intends to awaken an entire generation. That is Banning Liebscher from the Jesus Culture. It's seen in all different aspects of the church in America, the stirrings of revival, citing evangelists such as Reinhard Bonk, which is Christ for the Nations, the soon coming nationwide event with Billy Graham, Greg Laurie's Harvest Crusades, and also the spreading influence of the Jesus Culture conferences. A Charisma News article follows the current events and prayers for revival in the U.S. Certainly, churches all over the country responded to Billy Graham's preparation prior to his huge nationwide event on his 95th birthday, November 7th, when the renowned evangelist will host a massive evangelistic and Eucharistic, I might add, outreach to the country. Over 16,000 churches. See, you got a big numbers here. Big numbers. 16,000 churches and reportedly hundreds of thousands of people have registered to be a part of the My Hope outreach, which includes new messages from Graham, testimonies from others, and powerful worship, which means they're going to turn it up loud and bang the drums hard. That's what they're going to do. Meanwhile, Jesus Culture emanating from Bethel Church in Redding, not the Bethel Church in Area 52. And steered by director Banning Liebscher, has been traveling throughout the country, stirring hearts with worship and intercession, and recording such events, making them available for all believers to join in for your love offering of only $39.95. Listen to this now. Listen to this. The awakening is happening now, said one participant in the Jesus Culture event. It's happening now, and in no time, stadiums are going to be definitely filled. Now, let me read this here. But Liebscher says that I believe that is what God wants to release. He's releasing something because it's locked up somewhere, right? It's like in a prison and it needs to be released. You know what that is or who that is. I believe he wants to release faith in your heart for city, releasing it. I want you to lift up your voice, believing God intends to pour out his spirit from Los Angeles to New York City, from the West Coast to the East Coast, and he intends to awaken an entire generation. Billy Graham himself, according to the article, describes a, quote, great spiritual awakening coming to America. You say, well, Pastor, what is wrong with you? Don't you believe that? Like, God's power is going to be poured out on America. It's going to take over. Here's my, you know what I did? I left my Bible, my can of King James, out on the broadcast, Watchman broadcast desk. Hang on a second. Let me do this. Let me get my iPad Bible. I'll be preaching from the King James Version. Let's see here. Where do I want to go? See, with this, you can't hear the papers rattling. As I turn to 1 Thessalonians 5. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with a child, and they shall not escape. But ye brethren are not in darkness. Are not. Present, right now, tense. You are not in darkness. He didn't say, but brethren, you needed to have an awakening. He didn't say that. Because Paul knows that when you are born again, you are no longer in darkness. And that day will not overtake you as a thief. So there doesn't need to be an awakening for God's true saints and elect. It's already happened. We're already awake. It's a setup. People, I'm telling you, they're setting everybody up by trying to convince them that the church is asleep. Oh, we're so sleepy. We're not saving lost tribes, and we're not taking over America, and we don't have enough money. And they're trying to tell everybody that they're all asleep and they don't care. Now they're going to say, there's going to be an awakening. You know what that is, don't you? It's the Kundalini spirit rising up from the depths to open up and activate your pineal gland, which puts you to sleep. Ye brethren are not in darkness that the day should overtake you as a thief. You are all children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of the darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others. You see that? Because the awakening that Graham and his Eucharistic festivals with Roman Catholic priests doing confessions while he's preaching, that's the truth. The awakening that Greg Laurie and the Jesus culture and Bill Johnson and Joel Osteen and Todd Bentley and Oprah Winfrey are all talking about, and Rob Parsley and Rick Warren, the awakening that they're talking about is a revival of the spirit of Antichrist, because it's bound up and it's not being released because it's all in prison. It needs to be awakened and released. Just listen to see. It sounds like good religious talk, but it's as unbiblical and unscriptural as it gets, and it's a setup to set people. So that's why they talk up these big, huge, massive revivals everywhere. Because you can't have a real party unless you got 1,000 people there. It's like, have you ever... St. Louis is a baseball town, and I understand that. Have you ever watched a Florida-Miami Marlins baseball game? Have you ever seen, like, maybe you're in Florida and you've watched a Miami Marlins game, or you're a Cincinnati Reds fan or a Cubs fan? Ugh! And you watched them play the Marlins. Have you ever seen their stadium? They got this massive, beautiful stadium with all the amenities in the world. There's like 37 people there show up for the game. I don't know how they do it. And so when somebody from the Miami Marlins hits a base hit and scores a run, you hear... just not a lot of excitement going on. It's hard to do the wave with 38 people in the stadium. You go to a Cardinals game, there's 45,000 people all standing up, doing the wave and cheering on everybody that comes along. Even if you used to play for the Cardinals and you come back to the Cardinals stadium with another team, we will cheer you. Because you used to play for us. That's how it is here. And that's what these revivals are. They know that they can't build the hype in these small gatherings, in these small churches. So that's why they're promoting the stadium worship. Because then you can really feel the Spirit. I wanted to talk today about... I've been all worked up. Now I'm going to calm down a little bit. Where's my paperwork? I did this study last week, and it just really blessed my heart. Intercessory prayer. You know what? I got something bothering me. I'm going to deal with this first. I see a lot of you have written in, and boy, maybe I could just deal with emails today. We'll see. But I got an email from me. I don't know who this is. Me. And the email address is my email address. And I won't at blankety blank. I won't tell you who it is. So they don't identify themselves. You don't tell me who you are. So I don't have a clue who you are. And so, dear Pastor Mike, I have some questions about conditional election. I don't know what that is. Because I want to know the truth, and because I don't believe in conditional election, I don't know what that is. But I'm willing to consider both possibilities. Could you answer? Please answer these questions on PMO or email them back. So you're going to have to get your Bibles out, okay? And I may ask for your help, okay? Because I'll be honest with you. I don't just go around studying all these little isms and ideologies and some of this stuff I've never heard of before. Maybe you have experience with it. So if you know anything about conditional election, I've read the email, and I may be wrong, but I'm assuming that the writer, whoever me at my email address is a two-lipped Calvinist. That's what I'm assuming, because that's what it sounds like. Could you please answer these questions? When you say the elect are elected according to the foreknowledge of God, that's what the Bible says. Why couldn't it be that it is the foreknowledge of their thoroughly evil and God-hating hearts? That would be a reason for God to elect the people he loves, because he knows that they, if they go on like that, will end up in hell. Well, now, here's a problem I have with how you crafted this. For God to elect the people he loves, the problem is... according to Scripture, God doesn't just love four or five people in the world. According to Scripture, God so loved the world. God loves his creation. Saint or sinner, he loves them. So you're asking me, because I've said... and I think the Bible clearly lays this out, that man has a choice. We're not a robotic automaton, nor do we believe in a deistic God where he says, okay, I'll save you, but you're on your own after that, and you're going to have to stay saved if you want to. I don't believe that either, and the Bible doesn't teach that. But when you say you're elect according to the foreknowledge of God, the question is, I guess they think that God's foreknowledge of them being so wicked and evil is why he decided to elect them to save them from hell. I don't know that I see that scripturally. The second question, where in the scriptures is there proof that God's election is based upon the foreknowledge of what the elect will choose? Other than verses about the foreknowledge, which, for as far as I know, is the foreknowledge of their unrighteousness and unbelief. Now, let's look at, since you laid the parameters out, here is what all the places in the Bible of the foreknowledge of God have to do with, and it doesn't have anything in here to do with what you said here, the foreknowledge of their unrighteousness and unbelief. Here is Acts 2:23, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken him by wicked hands have crucified and slain. So God's foreknowledge of what they would do with Christ, he was part of it. Romans 8:29, for him for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now look at Romans 8:29 again. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. It is clear in Scripture that God foreknew, let's say Paul. God foreknew Paul, and God elected him on that foreknowledge. That is clear from the Scripture. God also foreknew Judas Iscariot. And yet Judas Iscariot actually performed the very will of God. And of course, Judas Iscariot is burning in hell right now. It's the truth. Did God choose Pharaoh to be that vessel of dishonor? Absolutely. Why? God knew the choices that Pharaoh would make. And if you don't believe in choice, I got news for you. Choice is the one thing that we have. And if I remember reading your email right, you almost said that choice was a work of salvation. It's not. It's a choice. We are not automatons that must strictly conform, whether our will desires to or not, to the will of God. God saw me, saw the entire outcome of my life. Nothing was a mystery to him whatsoever. And that's why he chose me. And so, according to, let's go back and look at a typology. Let's go back to the Garden of Eden. Here we have two trees in the midst of the garden. And Adam is not just being told, you will eat of the tree of life. He's clearly got a choice in that garden. Two trees. One, he's told, don't eat of that tree, lest ye die. You see, there can be no salvation without a choice. None. And then here's Joshua. Joshua 24:15. If it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for you and my house, we will serve the Lord. There is a verse. Let me see if I can find it here. Here it is, Deuteronomy 39. God says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that both thou and thy seed may live. Let me ask you a question. The 12 spies come back from the land of Canaan. 10 of them, which I love this, 10 represents the law. The law can't save you, and the law will tell you, you're not going. 10 of them come back and say, we can't go. There's no way we can go in there. And the children of Israel, because we have two now that come back, Joshua and Caleb come back and they say, God said we could. God said it's our land. They're trespassing on it. God said he would remove them for us. We have nothing to fear. Let's go. Come on, everybody. Let's go. Come on. Let's go. And Israel is standing there in the wilderness. And Israel had a choice. That's why it was divided up that way. That's why all 12 didn't come back and say, we can go in. That's why not all of them came back and said, all 12 said, we can't go in there. God clearly divided it up. And Israel sat in the wilderness and they voted. And they chose. And they said, we can't go. You have to ask the question, did God know that? Yeah, he knew it. He didn't make them choose that. He didn't force them to choose that. God wanted, his will and his desire was that they go in. But he gave it up. He let them make the choice. Else the 12 spies would have never gone into that land and brought a report back. They had a choice. And God let them die in the wilderness while he took the two, Joshua and Caleb. They got to go into the land. You know why? The Bible specifically says that Caleb had a different spirit in him than what was in Israel. Caleb was elected by God's foreknowledge of his choice, and that's why God put the spirit on him that he did. I mean, it's a big thing. I understand that. I understand people not really understanding predestination and foreknowledge and election. I mean, I get it. This is a big deal. But you cannot biblically excise or take away man's choice from God's purpose of salvation. You can't do it. Okay? Let me keep reading here. Let's see here. Where in the scriptures is there proof that God's election is based upon foreknowledge of that, of what the elect will choose, other than verses about foreknowledge? And she quotes Romans, she or he. Let's see if there's a name on here. No, there's not. Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Verse 11, there is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are altogether become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. And if that is left alone, you would then get the idea that no one ever chooses God, and God just reached in with a hook and pulled you up into heaven. Said, sorry, I don't know if you want to be here or not, but I'm taking you. That is not, you see, that is not, that one area of scripture is not the whole counsel of God. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That gift is not mandatory. It is an offering. It is a gift. It is something that is offered, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That in itself denotes choice and God's foreknowledge of that choice. Romans 8, 7 and 8, and this is their email, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be, so that they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But yes, there is more to me than flesh. My flesh hates God. My flesh hates God's laws. My flesh hates prayer. My flesh hates fasting. My flesh hates denial. But my soul and my spirit They're at war against my flesh, and we don't get along. And my soul and my spirit are in agreement, Mike. We're going to serve God. And so then I'm asked the question, why do you believe that Romans 3:10 and Romans 8 are not true? That's like asking me, Mike, have you stopped beating Lisa? If the Bible says it, it's true. And I believe every word of it. But what you've done is you've isolated these verses away from the preponderance of Scripture that teaches us that Israel, how many choices were they given? Even on the day that Christ was crucified, God did not leave them without a choice. And was it in the foreknowledge of God that because of him breaking off the branch of Israel so that he could put the Gentiles in? Absolutely. But the clear evidence of Scripture is that before God pulled them off, he stood their Savior and a murderer and a thief up before them and said, choose. And they chose. And God knew what they were going to choose. So now he offers the choice of salvation to us Gentiles. Then to ask the question, why is election according to someone's choice not work salvation? Well, that's kind of a silly question, because you don't actually quote verses that says choice is a work. And it's not. Choice is not a work. It's not a work of the law. It's not a work of righteousness. I'm not digging a ditch. I'm not paying money. I'm not sacrificing a lamb. It is a mental decision that I make to choose to serve God. So you say, why is election according to someone's choice not work salvation? If the election would be because of your choice, your salvation would be because of your choice. And if that were so, you obviously would have to deserve the salvation of Jesus Christ, which would be, I don't follow your, I have no idea what you're talking about. I have zero idea what you're talking about. None. Because you take this down a road, and apparently you're trying to make it look like that is what I believe and what I say, and the answer is no, I don't believe anything close to that. I don't know if I can make you understand from scriptures where I'm coming from, but I don't know why, and there's more than one person that does this. And I taught this the other day about repentance. And I'll have people shortly climbing all over me, making YouTube videos about the wolf in sheep's clothing, Mike Hoggard, because he preached about repentance. And you know, we're supposed to repent. Well, the Bible says repentance unto salvation. It's not a work, people. Godly sorrow worketh repentance. Godly sorrow. God did the work. We repented. And so I don't know where you get this idea that you think a choice is a work. Show me the scripture. If your salvation, this is their question, if your salvation was because you chose first, I never said chose first. Never said that. Never came out of my mouth. Because God with us doesn't see. He sees our whole life all at once. There is nothing about us, past, present, or future, that is hidden from what God knows about us. So it's not that God is waiting for us to make the choice and then he will elect us. He's already elected from before the foundation of the world based upon his knowledge of what he knows about us. But I never said choice first, never said it. Don't believe it. And then said, if your salvation was because you chose first, which would be the case if God elected you, because no, that's not it. Has nothing to do with it. And then number 7, you are right when you say that God offers salvation to everybody, but that is not, and then the email ends. I don't know what's after that. So I wanted to deal with that. It's been bugging me the whole time. And there's your answer. I mean, you said some things here. I'm not trying to be adversarial to you. I don't know who you are. You didn't identify yourself. You could be K downstairs. I don't think so. But you clearly delineated and tried to characterize things that I said in a way that I didn't say it. Never said it. Don't believe it. But you cannot scripturally take choice out of the equation of salvation. You can't do it. It's clearly there. And it's everywhere. It's in the Old Testament. It's in the New Testament. You just can't take that out. You know what? Let's be on a roll here and deal with some other emails. Pastor Mike, I've heard it said different ways. We are the spirits that possess a soul and inhabit a body. And we are souls that have a spirit and live in a body. The Bible says when God breathed into man, he became a living soul. And that's good enough for me. However, other people say since we are in the image of God, and Jesus said God is a spirit, then we must also be spirits first. I appreciate it if you can clarify. No. Because I'll be honest with you. I don't have a clue what it would mean if we are a spirit that possess a soul and inhabit a body, or we're a soul that has a spirit and live. I don't see the... I don't know that it means anything. I'm just being honest. In my experience, Catfish, this is who wrote it, Catfish did. In my experience, Catfish, people who say stuff like this usually have a doctrinal agenda that's behind it. They got some doctrine that they want to stuff on you that's really not in the Bible, but they have to set up this saying, well, we are a spirit first that inhabits this and blah blah. I've never run into this ever. And I cannot think of a verse in my mind that says that, well, this is first and this is the most important and whatever. The truth of it is, God gave us a flesh body, a soul and a spirit, and then he's going to give us a new body. And it's, to me, it's, that's it. That's all I know. Mike. Hey, Pastor Mike, just wondering, sometimes I'm having trouble keeping the faith. Is this normal? I try and read my KJB and listen to sermons by you, but sometimes I get a spirit of unbelief that comes over me, and there's almost like a fight going on inside my head. I'm just wondering, is that normal thing? Yeah, it's like I said earlier, Mike, you've got a flesh, you got a brain, and it is evil, and it doesn't seek God, and it hates God's guts, but that's not all who you are. The spirit, Jesus himself said, the spirit warreth against the flesh wars against the spirit. The spirit truly is willing, the flesh is weak. And one is always contrary. Paul struggled with the two laws, the one in his inner man and the one in his flesh. And he said, that law that's in my flesh is contrary to the law of grace that I have on the inside of me. And so, when you say unbelief, I don't know exactly what you say. I don't believe in God anymore, or I'm not sure about this whole salvation thing. I don't believe I'm saved or what. But I can tell you, Mike, that you're not the only one that ever struggles with anything like this. You're not the only one. Every now and then, I've been honest with people about my struggles as I've lived this life. Now, one of the things that I don't have confidence in is me, my flesh. What I have confidence in is God has kept me and preserved me, even at times when I wasn't all that big on God. And keep in mind, I've been in church every service since I was about 8 years old. And I've been in church and not right with God. It can be done. Let's see here. Some folks from New York. Let me read the email first before I say your name, because I want to make sure. Thanks again for a great homecoming. Received a phone call from the church we were attending, the Problem Church, more or less asking if we have left since we're not there Sunday. That, you know, that's kind of, hey, y'all leave the church yet? You know, because, you know, we got stuff we want to do. The discussion about the KJ Bible being the inerrant word of God continued. I was challenged to prove by the KJV that it was the inerrant word of God. And Jerry, this is, I'll go ahead and say your name. Jerry, this is real easy. It's real easy, okay? My response was, can you prove that it's not the inerrant and has mistranslations? He cannot do so. Is there scripture that proves it is inerrant? Upon searching, all I could come up with 1 Peter 24:25, for all flesh is grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and flower fadeth, thereof falleth. But the word of our God, the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word by which the gospel is preached unto you. Go back one verse, Jerry. 1 Peter 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but by incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And say, look right here. I'm only doing what my Bible says for me to do. My Bible says that it's inerrant. My Bible says that it's incorruptible. My Bible says in Psalms 12 that the words are pure and that they have been and will always be preserved forever. Every word. And yet you tell me that they're not preserved. So who's not telling me the truth? Is it my Bible? Am I believing something that my Bible should not be saying to me? Or should I just believe you when you tell me that my Bible has mistakes in it, when my Bible tells me it has no mistakes in it? Jerry, here's what you did. You said you responded, prove to me that it's not the inerrant and has mistranslations. Here's the thing, Jerry. None of these Bible doubters and Bible correctors can ever point you to the verse that says the Bible fadeth away. They can't do it. They give you philosophical arguments. They give you textual manuscript evidence. They give you Hebrew and Greek lessons. They never quote scripture. Never. They don't have a verse in 1,189 chapters in the Bible, they don't have one verse that says the Bible would ever have mistakes in it. No verses. So you did right. You did the right thing. Catfish again. Have you ever thought the world Illuminati kingpin family Rothschild is really Ashtaroth's child? No, actually, it's Red Shield. The Red Shield family. And there is a verse in the Bible that talks about the Red Shield family. Go look it up. Okay? Let's see here. Pastor Mike, I want to thank you for your teaching. You helped me understand so much in the Word of God that I'm always looking forward for a new video. Pray the Lord will continue to bless your ministry and that He may... May you continue to bring more souls to the Lord. It seems that... After I took on several days of fasting, I've been attacked severely. Yep, that happens. Let's see here. I also know that God is faithful and there is nothing impossible for Him. I wanted to ask your advice about a couple of things. First, I feel that a couple of my siblings are anxious to see me fail. That sounds about right. They're saying about me things like, how come he does not own a house like all of us do? Things like that make me feel a bit inferior to them, for all of them own a house and they're all married. Big deal. My marriage did not last. My credit is in shambles, and I also know that that material stuff does not define me, and I know that my God is more than able to raise me up according to His will and His purpose. I have forgiven them, and I pray that God will continue to bless them and their children. What else do you suggest that I do in order that I do not hinder my blessings? Do not hinder my blessings. Blessings come to God's people because they believe. Not because they have or don't have, but because they believe what God said. And I mean, I don't know you, so it's, you know, kind of hard for me to discern. Well, you know, whatever. As long as you are living your life, your lifestyle, in accordance with what the Word of God teaches, then I wouldn't really worry so much about what everybody else thought of you. I mean, I wouldn't do it. Now, if you're doing something that is in violation of the Word of God, and that's the reason why your marriage busted up and you ain't got a house and your credit's in shambles, then I can say to you, you had it coming, okay? I mean, you had it coming. And so quit whining because you brought it on yourself. But I don't know that. I mean, I don't. I just don't know enough about you and the situation to be able to say, yeah, this is how it needs to be. Let's see here. Miss Hernandez is going to pray about coming to homecoming. Appreciate that. Come on down. Matt says, God bless Pastor Mike Hoggard and all the congregation of Bethel. He has, Matt. Appreciate that. Rick says, I live in Redding, California, where there is a large Bethel church that was split by the false teacher Bill Johnson who brought in the Toronto curse. I was in a church that split in Wilmington, North Carolina, by a pastor in the same church splitting curse from Toronto. This is a spirit of error that is still running wild in churches. You should look into it and those that are still pushing it. I'm an ex-Catholic and ex-charismatic. Good for you, Rick. And yeah, you're right. I didn't know the church split. I'd like to know some more about that. Chip says, Pastor Mike, please, please, please pray for me. I was in a bad car wreck last Friday. Had some crazy guy with road rage hit my car into another van, striking them head on. It didn't kill me or the other people, but messed us up pretty bad. Anyway, please pray this crazy man will get caught. Even though have the guy's identity in his green truck. The state patrol said they cannot do anything until I get his name and license tag plates. Now I have no car to get back and forth to work. My insurance won't even cover me until I get the guy who hit me. Wow. That doesn't sound right. They won't do anything until they have a guy to blame. That doesn't sound right to me. But we're going to pray for you, Chip, all right? Let's see here. What else can I... Can I get in trouble today? I'm thinking of joining a church that uses the KJV and seems to have some good, solid doctrine. One problem is that they think that spiritual gifts ended when the Bible was completed. Where is that in the Bible? I wonder if they even pray. Well, I don't know that I would take it that far. I'm not a Pentecostal, but the Bible seems to indicate that some of the elect have them. I think that most people have spiritual gifts actually don't. I have a problem ruining God's power and reconciling Scripture to their beliefs. Should I stay away, and is it a dead church? I don't know that. I wouldn't say that they were. Sounds like this church is just simply making a statement saying, don't come in here with your tongues and your prophecies and stuff like that. And Thomas, I've been teaching on Sunday morning in Sunday school that the gifts of the Spirit, they are in the Word of God, and they are administered in that fashion. You want, and like the gift of discernment, you read enough of that Bible and all of a sudden you're going to be able to pick on stuff that you never saw before in life. And that is a gift of the Holy Ghost. And so I'm assuming that this church sort of has that same idea in mind. Okay. So I don't know that I would just not even go over here to this church. If they're preaching that book, I think I'd get over there and check them out a little bit longer before I decided to leave, because there was one thing you didn't agree on. Okay? You need a church. Okay? Whatever. Somebody told me there was trollers out there that are going to try to troll and write stuff in to get attention. And today's not your day. Sorry. Angel Is it really an angel? Pastor Mike, when I listen to this program, sometimes it just seems to me like a reflection of what Jesus went through. He went about preaching, and just about everywhere he preached, there came someone trying to catch him in a snare, trying to trap him and disprove him. I don't know if it's just me, or it does seem like a lot of these people that ride in to try to catch you in a snare, they try to make what's simple and plain turn it into something that difficult, and I just can't stand that. And I agree with you. I don't mind answering objections. I don't mind answering questions. I don't mind, you know, the Bible says give an answer to everyone, to give proof of thy ministry. So I don't mind doing that. But I know also, Angel, that there's people out there that no matter what I say, here's another one. It's another troll. Wow. Well, you guys are all over the place. But I don't mind answering questions, but some people I am never in a million years going to be able to convince them, even by giving them scripture, because they don't listen to scripture. They've listened to the book they've read, or they listen to John Calvin or whatever somebody, or whatever Rick Warren said. They listen to that, and they will not regard the plain, very simple teaching of scripture. So I appreciate that, and boy, there's another one. The trollers are out there, and I'm not reading your stupid email. Okay? Not going to do it. Let's see here. Stephen. Pastor Mike, the email you just read, I think he's asking if we were souls first, and as a result of sin that we were given flesh. No, that's... Man, I missed my Bible. Let's go read the King James Bible. I'd never heard that before. I've never read that one in the Bible, that we were souls first and that God, after we sinned, gave us dirt bodies. Let's see here. Verse 26, Genesis 1, God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And then in Genesis 2, let's see here. And the Lord God, Genesis 2:7, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And it's very clear to me that man was created, formed out of the dust of the ground with his flesh body before he ever sinned. And so if someone... If someone says that God created us to be souls first and then gave us a flesh after we sinned, that's not what it says. So I don't agree with that. Good grief, there's another one. Hi, guys. Here's another one. Hi. Odessa says, Pastor Mike, even Elijah told Israel to choose this day who they would serve, God or Baal on Mount Carmel. There's this pseudo-intellectual spirit that I've always loathed with Calvinism. Either you believe the whole word of God or you don't. Or we are truly in the days of Noah. Odessa, I appreciate that. Here's another one. Good grief. Here we go. Let's see here. Do we got any more stupid people? Yeah, there's another one. Man. Anyway. You guys, knock that off. You're like so wasting your breath on me today, I guarantee you. Okay? Why don't you go sign up illegal aliens to vote? Okay? go spend your time on that instead of wasting your time on me. Good grief. Chemo says, hey, Pastor Mike, saw the movie Elysium. I got my eye on this one. I saw the preview of it, and I'm going, I know what that is. This past weekend, and then saw your latest WVB, the Comic Con. It was interesting that you mentioned regeneration being the key to immortality in the agenda of the coming world system. In the movie, it shows the marking of a code in the right arm, then using a medical bed authorized by the code DNA in the right arm to cure whatever problem your body is facing in order to live longer. Also, the dying god, Matt Damon, that demon guy, yeah. Matt Damon, he was Jason Bourne. Now, I got to say, the Jason Bourne movies were awesome, okay? But anyway, that's my flesh, I know. Also, the dying god who was exposed to radiation and facing imminent death in 5 days, he takes on a suit like a droid to enhance his abilities, like the Iron Man. At the end of the movie, he dies to save all mankind, to allow them to become citizens of Elysium, so that all will be allowed to receive the mark, to use the med bed to heal all infirmities, and so on. Let's see here. There were a lot of other things, like Elysium being in the form of a pentagram and having a circle within a circle. Just wanted to share this. I'm probably not going to see it at the movie, but I'm going to get this movie when it comes out, and you'll be hearing from me on this. I guarantee you. Carson, Pastor Mike, I love you, man. Love you back, Jack. However, let me say, according to Scripture, there's none that doeth good, and though man has a choice, this choice has no part in salvation. Quote Scripture. Question, what choice did you have in your physical birth? None. What choice do you suppose that you have in your spiritual birth? Now, see, you're giving me an intellectual argument with no Scripture. You show me Scripture that says I have no choice in my spiritual birth. Show me the Scriptures. Don't give me your intellectual garbage. Don't give me your intellectual stuff. I don't mean to be mean to you. I love you, man. I do. But that idea is not biblical. It's not there. So if you want to present this to me, and I am all willing to hear you out scripturally, but if you want to present this to me, don't give me philosophical arguments. Don't say, well, let's reason this and this and this and this. Give me Scripture that says that you don't get a choice to be saved. Show me the verse. Show me the verse. And actually, you'll need to. Anyway, let me see. Pastor Mike, should I stay away from the Book of Enoch? Absolutely. Don't read it. It's junk. It's going to lead you astray. Beware of the blob. And leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door, all around the world. Any more? I'm looking for the trolls. Now, I got about 9. Oh, here's another one. Here's another one. Good grief. Go sign up some illegal aliens, all right? Don't waste your time on me anymore. I'm not going to read any more of your stupid emails. It's probably the same person. I love you. You need to be saved. You need Jesus Christ in your heart. You need to repent of your sins. That's what you need to do. Don't waste your time trying to aggravate me. Get saved before it's too late. See ya.